progress.
Allora, so let me discuss this disconnection between the Lyapunov exponent and fractal dimension of the attractor. So why this is a conjecture? It's called Kaplan-York. As far as I know, it has been proved only in very, very peculiar situation, not particularly interesting. So in 2D uniformly hyperbolic map. So. And why is important? It's important because you can, for example, compute the dimension of the attractor. Now, don't worry which dimension, just dimension. Using Grasberger-Procaccia. Okay. But if you use So you compute this stuff. Huh? This, for example, is a way to compute the 1 over n square. This like d2. Okay. So why not this? Imagine that. What means to do this? You perform a log-log plot, a log of this quantity here, a log of epsilon, and you have some point. Okay, and so you need some point, and then you perform a fit. So in order to have this fit, so you need, you say, 2 decads, just to say, 1 decad and a half, okay? Just to be generous, well, say 2 decads. Okay, if you, so between here, there is 10, 100, okay? So if you have 100, this means that how many points you need in order to have something like that. So you realize that the number of points you need to have this is like this. Okay, if you take 100, otherwise you have another number. So you see that if d is larger, means let's say 10, okay, here you have 10 to 20. So and this is absolutely out of any possibility. Okay. So you see that you realize that if you want 2 decads, the order of magnitude of number is this one. So if you want 1 decad and a half, say instead of 40, you have it's not very different. Huh? It's not very different. Okay. So you see that this increases exponentially with d. So this is a practical limitation. Okay. It's not possible to use this method to compute the dimension. Like 15 or 20, okay? So now, so this is a problem. This is a practical problem, it's not conceptual, it's a practical. And then, for this reason, it's important to, on the contrary, there is no limitation to compute Lyapunov exponent. You can compute all Lyapunov exponent you want. You have a system with 100,000 variable, and you can compute 100,000 Lyapunov exponent. So it's just a matter of time, but. So the idea of Kaplan and York is the following. Imagine that you have lambda 1, lambda 2, and so on. And these are ordered. This is larger equal than this, larger equal than this, and so on. The conjecture is the following. So here you have J. This is 1, then you have 2, 3, and so on. So here you put the sum of the Lyapunov exponent ordered from 1 to j. Okay? So you start from here, then I have this, then I have another this, maybe I have 0, and then so on. At a certain time, this increase and then decrease, and then I have something like that. Okay? Let me call this j star. J star is the last value such that the sum is positive. Well, for j star plus 1, the sum is negative. Well, the conjecture of these two gentlemen is that the dimension, now don't worry which dimension, so now it's not actually the conjecture is for D1, but don't worry. D is equal J star. So the idea is that this point, okay? The J star plus something. So this is linear interpolation. Okay, this is the conjecture. Now, before to discuss the origin of this conjecture, this conjecture has been proved only in very few particular systems. But this is very important. The importance is that in this way you can compute the dimension. You can compute the dimension because there is no difficulty in the computation of the Lyapunov exponent. Okay, and for example, you can check this. You can check so for example, in the 2D maps. Like Enona, this formula say that D is equal 1 plus lambda 1 over lambda 2. So in Lorentz, you have to remind that in Lorentz, the second Lyapunov exponent is 0. And so this formula give 2 plus lambda 1 over lambda 3 modulus. Okay, you have this formula. Okay. So and then you can check, for example, you can check if there is a good agreement. And actually, this is the agreement is good. It's just an empirical remark, okay? But how this gentleman had this idea? What is the reasoning? The reasoning is the following. The reason is the following. So you have this attractor. So the attractor is something which is, by definition, is invariant under the evolution. And then you take when you look at the K Lyapunov exponent, KZ, no? We discussed yesterday, and I look at the volume, at the increasing or decreasing of the volume given by this tangent vector. So Z1 time T, Z2, and so on. Okay, this volume, let me call this volume K, okay? So what happened? So this volume go like the sum of the Lyapunov exponent up to K, okay? So if K is smaller than this quantity, if K is smaller or equal J star, you have that the volume diverge in time when t go to infinity. Okay, if k is greater or equal than j star plus one, this go to zero. So you expect that the dimension must be between this and this because by definition the dimension the volume compute with the because this volume increase, so this is not enough. And this decrease, so it's too much, okay? And so you say, must be between this, okay? Between, there is no particular argument to say how in between, just to be simple, you take a linear interpolation, okay? This is the argument, very end-wavy argument. I'll admit it's very end-wavy argument. But in 2D map, you can produce another argument, which is more convincing, but you arrive at the same result. Okay. Let me explain the argument in 2D with, and you can repeat the argument even for Lorentz because it's the same. The argument is the following. So for the 2D map, 2D map, 2D map. So in 2D map, you have lambda 1 positive and lambda 2 negative, such a way lambda 1 plus lambda 2 are negative. Okay. So this means if I start, so we have an attractor. So this means that if I start for something like that, start with a square, okay? This in time evolve, and yesterday we understood that must be something like that. This is not the proper picture, also, okay? And so this t equals zero, this t large. So let me call this L. So you have that at zero. So the length of this curve will increase like the first Lyapunov exponent. So the length time t is like L0 lambda 1 time t. The transversal, this thickness, let me call epsilon, increase in time, decrease in time according to the second Lyapunov exponent. It's like L0 L2, where this is like, this is negative, so it's L0 L minus L2. Okay? You have this. Okay, this is trivial. Now, now you try to, now, after a certain time, you have an attractor asymptotically. So now you can decide, you have to count how many square of size epsilon t I need to cover this stuff. So this is clear. So the number of epsilon t is this length divided by this. This is the argument. Okay, this is correct. This L of t divide epsilon of t. And so I have what I have. I have L1 plus modulus of lambda 2 to t. Okay? But now I want to write this in term of epsilon. So if I write this in term of epsilon, this epsilon, I have to write L my L2 times t to something. Okay. What is the something? The something is one. You see, you can see that this is correct. If I take d equal 1 plus lambda 1 over lambda 2, no, sorry, minus. You see that this is true. This is the argument. Okay, okay, I understand. This is an end wave argument. It's not. But it's a bit convincing. It's rather convincing. So if you repeat with Lorentz, it's the same. But you have to remind that there is here there is a factor two because there is a neutral direction. So you see that magically this coincides with the previous argument, and so you can check numerically, and the agreement is rather good. And okay, so some mathematician, what is the Chinese lady in New York, Lai Sang Yang, this Chinese lady, who is professor in New York, proved that this is true, where this is D1, what yesterday I called D1, for two-dimensional maps uniformly hyperbolic. Okay. Whatever it means, don't worry. Okay, this is the connection between these two problems. Now, let me spend the last time discussing a chaos in Hamiltonian system, because up to now.
Sorry, Angelo, what is the fact that lambda 1 plus lambda 2 must be negative?
Must be negative because must be dissipative.
Ah, okay.
This is dissipation. This is the contraction of the volume. So let me now discuss the Hamiltonian system. So the chaos in Hamiltonian system is extremely important because Hamiltonian system are an important part of the mathematics applied to physics. And the Hamiltonian system are very specific situation, which somehow are not generic. So usually the system is not Hamiltonian. So if you have an Hamiltonian system, you perturb slightly, you destroy the Hamiltonian character. Okay, but it's important. I guess it's not necessary I convince you that the Hamiltonian systems are important. Okay? So what means Hamiltonian system? Hamiltonian system means that X is equal to given by a set P of Q, and you have a certain quantity which is called Hamiltonian. Maybe it can also depend from time, but now let me, so, and you have the Hamiltonian equation. You have Q dot N equal ma equal this, and P dot N equal minus. Okay, so typically we have something like that, but it's not necessary. Yeah, it's not necessary that we have something like that. Typically you have something, something like some interacting stuff. Typically you have something like this, but it's not necessary. Q say R to something, okay? So the simple case is when N equal one. N equal one is trivial, so you know, equal one is trivial. It's trivial in the sense that N equal one, you have the Hamiltonian, is something like P square over 2M plus this, okay? And this is absolutely trivial, it's absolutely elementary. Why is elementary? Because you have, imagine that V diverge to infinity, so you have something like that, for example. This is V. So if you do the plot here, Q, here, P, so if you fix a certain energy here, so you have, you know that in your undergraduate course that you have periodic motion here. Maybe it's not exactly sine, cosine, because this, no? But however, it's for sure periodic, no? So if you are here, you have something like that. So you have something like okay. I'm not very smart. You have always periodic motion. Okay. So the case n equal one and h autonomous. The system is trivial in the sense that is periodic, and you can find the solution just solving an equation, solving an integral. Maybe the integral is difficult, but don't worry. So a part of the difficulty of performing the explicit integral, the situation is trivial. What is non-trivial is when n is in larger dimension, the situation is not trivial, and you can wonder if it's possible to solve explicitly the problem in an analogy of what you are able to do in 1D. Okay, so what is the approach? So you study in your course in analytical mechanics that so you have Q P, and you perform a canonical transformation, which preserves the Hamiltonian structure. So, and you try to obtain a new Hamiltonian which depends only from the action and not the angle. If you are able to do this, if you are able, then you are very happy. You are very happy because now, if you write again this equation, what you have that theta point n is equal derivative of this n, and so you see this is just a function of I. So this is, let me call a omega n i, and you have I dot equals 0. No? So you see that you have that this is constant. And this is trivial, this is just a rotation. And that's it, okay? So if you are able to put the system in this form, you solve the problem, okay? And the question is that, is possible to do this or not? Because if it's possible generically, means that we are able to solve all the Hamiltonian system, all the Hamiltonian problem, okay? So the problem is the following. Very general question. Is possible to find a canonical transformation such that blah, blah, blah? If yes, that's it. No, for example, in some cases we know. How many cases you know that this is possible to do? There are only two cases. Harmonic oscillator and two-body problem, two-body gravitational problem. This is in classical mechanics. In quantum mechanics, the same. Hydrogen atoms, which correspond to Kepler problem, and harmonic potential. So the unique two situations where it's possible to do this explicitly, apart from some particular, are the harmonic oscillator, or a set of harmonic oscillator, and the Keplerian problem. For the rest, you can wonder why the people didn't try other pathological situation such that there is some deep reason. Okay, this problem has been investigated from the very beginning of, from very beginning means starting from Newton, okay? So, in particular, the people try to understand the problem in astronomy. So, because in astronomy, you have the two-body problem, two-body problem means sun plus planet. One planet, one. Plus one planet, we solve the problem, we have the Kepler law and so on, okay? This is okay, this is easy. Now, the next step is three-body. Sun plus planet plus asteroid. For example, Sun, Jupiter, and an asteroid. In first approximation, the solar system is Jupiter. The mass of Jupiter is much larger compared with the mass of the rest of the solar system, apart the Sun. Okay. So now the next problem is to consider the Sun, a planet, and an asteroid. So this problem is integrable. So it is in this form. The problem of the three-body problem, you have something like that. So that you have an integrable part, which corresponds to the situation where you neglect the asteroid, and then you have an interaction. So typically the problem in mechanics is that you have an evident integral part plus something disturbing. So this is very typical, no? In quantum mechanics you have a problem you can solve and then you have a certain perturbation, okay? And so you want to understand the problem in terms of the starting problem. So the idea, what is? The idea is to find, is to repeat this game, no? To look for a canonical transformation such that. So the problem is that look for a canonical transformation such that this canonical transformation I theta go to I prime theta prime in such a way, this go like if I am able to do this, is the end of the game, because now for this I have a conservation law. No? If this is true, then means that I have a prime n equal constant. And that's it. This is the end of the story. Okay? So you know that you can formulate the problem in this way, or alternative, but it's the same. So you see that in the case where epsilon equals zero, you have n integral of the motion. So all the i are constant. Okay. Then you can wonder if epsilon is small. If epsilon is small, question. There exist non-trivial integrable well, because if there exists, then I repeat the game, no? This is constant and so on. Okay, these are equivalent. You can formulate the problem in terms of canonical transformation or look for the existence of a non-trivial conservation law. Of course, the energy is conserved, okay? Then remove the trivial conservation law, right, Bari center and so on, okay? So this is the problem. This problem has been considered, so the story of the three-body problem is very long. It starts from Newton, and all the giants of mathematics try to work in this, Euler, Laplace, Lagrange, Weierstrass, so all these eminent, all the people who are in the books of mathematics, and with the very weak, very, very poor result. So the existence of some particular situation, but very, very poor, okay? The person who solved the problem, no, solved, the, not solved the problem in the sense that was able to find the solution, who explained the reason of the difficulty was Poincaré, okay? Poincaré, so now let me present this very important result of Poincaré, which is at the basis of Henri Poincaré. Around 1800, roughly, maybe something less, he proved the following result. Theorem. So you have H 0 plus epsilon, so on. If epsilon is different from zero, there are not integrable motion. Okay, not non-trivial. Of course, there are trivial. The trivial is obvious, but you remove the trivial. You write the system in such a way you already remove the trivial. Okay. Okay. And this is very bad news. This is very bad news because it means that the idea to find a change of a variable such that is not possible. Okay. So the reason why this giant in the past didn't succeed to find the solution was not because he was not smart enough, but because it's really impossible. They didn't realize this, okay? How is possible to prove this? Okay, this is very, very simple computation, very nice. Poincaré wrote an enormous paper. The paper is 274 pages. It's true that at that time the people wrote all the detail, no? There are many things in this work, but what I present is just a few pages of this, but which is very important from a general point of view. The rest of the paper is important for the problem of three body and so on. The computation is the four, and is interesting not only of the conclusion, but also why you understand where is the difficulty of the problem. Okay. So the idea is the following. So for epsilon equals zero, so you have a certain function which is constant. So for example, let me take f, then just a certain action, for example. Just to say. And then you can wonder now you can wonder well, epsilon is different from zero, smaller. I look for an f, which now must depend from I and theta, okay. Which is, of course, you start with this, plus epsilon f1 I theta, plus epsilon square f2 I theta, and so on, constant. Okay, you look for this. So you use essentially the idea you study in elementary quantum mechanics, the perturbative theory, and of course you have to be careful, you have to compute all the terms and so on, okay? And apparently the problem seems simple, and so you look for a set of equation for f1, f2, such that in such a way this is constant. How is possible to do this? So what means that a certain quantity is constant in a Hamiltonian system? It means that is Poisson bracket is zero. Okay, this constant means that f i theta h must be zero. Okay, then I write this explicitly. So here I have f0 plus epsilon, f1 plus epsilon square, f2, and so on. And here is h0 plus epsilon h1. This is equal to zero. Okay? I write this explicitly. So if I write this explicitly, I have f0, h0 plus epsilon, plus epsilon. F1, H0 plus epsilon, plus epsilon square, F2, H0 plus epsilon, HI, and so on. Okay? All this must be zero. So, now, this is F0, h0 plus epsilon f0 hi plus epsilon f1 h0 plus epsilon square f1 e plus epsilon square f2 a0 plus epsilon cube, che c'è qua, f2, and so on, okay? You got it. All this stuff must be zero. Must be zero for any epsilon, okay? So this means, okay, this is zero for sure, because this is the important, this is zero. Now you look at the term order epsilon, this is the term order epsilon, and this is the term order epsilon square. Okay, then you have the other term, okay? So the first is okay. The first term is already okay. And you look for the first order, so the order epsilon. So the order epsilon, you have to kill this term. So this must be equal to this. So you have F1, H0 equal to minus F0, order epsilon square, you have you have F2, H0 equal minus F, 1. Okay. If you go to the other order, you obtain some. If you go to the other order, you have F3. H0 equal to minus F2. And so on. So apparently, this is usual chain of equation, maybe boring, but in perturbative system. So you see, from this, you expect naively, you say, okay, I know, I solve F1. So from this, I solve F1. So I found F1, that's it. I take F1 and put here. So I have an equation for F2. So, and I found F2. I put here. And I have F3, and so on, okay? It's boring, but so, yeah. At least then I can stop when I will be exhausted. I consider this is enough, okay? So apparently is the usual, apparently this is a usual perturbative computation. Well, it's not particularly, nobody loves too much these things, but the life is tough, no? So apparently the problem seems a usual problem in perturbative system. This is, and then he say, okay, if you are a mathematician, you have to do this, then you have to check if the convergence, is the convergence is uniform, all these things, no? This is, before to worry about the convergence, you have to compute this stuff, okay? And apparently there is a precise protocol. Apparently. The problem is that now, let it look carefully, and look at the F1. Look at F1, and we realize that F1 doesn't exist. Poincaré realized that F1 doesn't exist. Even in the most, optimistic situations. The most optimistic situation means that HI is, analytical function, so very smooth with infinite derivative and so on. Maybe I stop here. Yeah. So okay. So the result that he obtained, I stop here, and then I continue later, that this quantity doesn't exist. It's not possible to find this. And this is the end of the story. This is the end of the story. So the problem is not to check the convergence, because the first term of the series doesn't exist. And so this means that this procedure is impossible. So you can rephrase this in terms of canonical transformation. You arrive exactly at the same result. You arrive exactly at the same result. And there appear a trouble, and the trouble is called a small denominator. So there is a certain quantity in the denominator of the expression, which you are not able to control, in the sense that this can be arbitrarily small. Since it's in the denominator, means that system, the quantity must be arbitrarily large. And so this is the end of the story. This was the end of the story at that time. So. And it was necessary to arrive at 1945, which is an important year for the dynamical system, for two reasons. Because I was born that year. But it's only personal, and because there is an important theorem, not from me, of course, but from Kolmogorov, okay? This is very important here. And what necessary to spend some years from the work of Poincaré and the work of Kolmogorov, and where Kolmogorov was able to put some order in a situation which apparently the people had the idea was hopeless, okay? Actually, it's not so hopeless, but at least it's difficult, okay? This is Poincaré, what I am discussing, and this is Kolmogorov. Kolmogorov I just mentioned, because entering the work of Kolmogorov is, I need 20 hours, roughly, okay. Kolmogorov and then the other name. Kolmogorov Arnold Moser, what is called KEM theory. Okay, now I stop. After the break, I show you the origin of the trouble, which is not a mathematical problem, which is not a mathematical difficulty. It is a real fact. This is the real origin. It's not, it's not possible to do this because we are not smart enough. No, this is the trouble. The trouble is real. It's a physical trouble. It's a real trouble. Okay.
So we take 5 minutes break.
Fondamentale. Hanno fondamentale.
Recording stopped.